Genesis 50, last chapter in Genesis. Have a look at it from verse 15 to verse 21. It's the story of Joseph forgiving his brothers. Here we go. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, that's Jacob, they said, "What if Joseph still holds a grudge against us and pays us back for all the wrongs we did him?" So they sent word to Joseph saying, "Your father left these instructions before he died. This is what you were to say to Joseph. I ask you to forgive your brothers the sins and the wrongs they committed in treating you so badly. Now please forgive the sins of the servants of the God of your father." When their message came to him, Joseph wept. His brothers then came, threw themselves down before him. "We are your slaves," they said. But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God meant it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Genesis 50. It's an amazing picture because you're talking about years after the event. I want to think about forgiveness and how it operates and how you do it properly and what it looks like when you don't do it properly. And because you see, if Christianity is nothing else, it is a revelation of two interrelated things, love and forgiveness. And it's the love of God that comes to us, that is initiated. It comes to us and it initiates a response. It demands a reciprocal response. And that love is tied up really closely with forgiveness. God forgives us and so enables us to forgive other people. Are you with me? It's a huge central truth, love and forgiveness. And a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you. John chapter 13. Do as I have done to you. You remember when he was washing their feet, he said, "You see what I'm doing? And if I, your Lord, wash your feet, I've set you an example. This is how you are to deal with one another. Put yourself beneath them. Serve one another." And he said, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." In Matthew chapter 6. Now this call for us to love is described as a new commandment. But it wasn't created by the gospel. The gospel didn't make God love us. The gospel revealed God's love for us. The gospel didn't make it our duty to forgive and to love. It only revealed something that was an eternal order that was written in the fabric of creation. And John says, "I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which you've had since the beginning. The old commandment is the word which you've heard from the beginning. Again, a new commandment I write to you, which thing is true in him and in you, because the darkness is past and the true light now shines." So it was old because of the eternal order of love, and it was new because it was shown and revealed in the light of the love of Jesus. So Christianity is real life, right? True humanity. It's life as it should be lived. It's the way, it's the truth, it's the life, it's Jesus himself. It's ancient and it's revolutionary and new. So here's the proof. Centuries before Jesus came to the earth, centuries before those words were spoken, comes the story of Joseph, and Christianity is a revelation of the real truth of life that had been here yesterday, today, and forever. The truth of Jesus is forever the same. And so the instances of forgiveness and love that we find in the life of Joseph is the truth that is eternal. That's my point. And so we have the story of Joseph. Joseph being sought to forgive his brothers. He'd been abused and left for dead by his brothers. He'd been sold into slavery. He'd gone into prison because of false accusation. He spent years. He'd spent the half of his life suffering from the consequences of the sin of his brothers. And now the tables have turned, he's in power, and they have a feeling that things are about to change. And the catalyst for this new situation is the death of Jacob, their father. They think that as long as Jacob's alive, Jacob has now come down into Egypt, they've settled there, they're living there, and all is rosy in the garden, there's no famine, everything is taken care of, Joseph is the top man in the country, it's fine, all things great, but now Jacob's died, and they think, right at the end of the book of Genesis, they think, what if all these years he's been bearing this grudge? You know what grudges do? They fester like an ancient infection inside you, and they change the way you think about a certain person or a certain situation. And if they're not dealt with, it's like a cancer that just lies there dormant and malignant. And they think now that Jacob has died, this grudge is going to erupt into payback. What happens next? We'll come to it later. God bless.